Proverbs chapter 2. And to God be the glory. Glory to God. Everybody there? Let's start at verse 1. Proverbs chapter 2 and starting at verse 1. My son, if you receive my words and treasure my commands within you, so that you incline your ear to wisdom and apply your heart to understanding, if you cry out for discernment and lift up your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as for hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Now that was a plan. It was a direction. God just gave us a master map in finding hidden treasures, hidden mysteries that are in His presence. And there are things that you can only get in His presence that are not written. They'll be confirmed by the Word, but they're not written. They're inscrolled for eternity. There are things that God can reveal to you that will blow your mind. The Spirit tells us things to come. Things to come. He said He'll guide us in all ways. These are areas where you and I, as we begin to walk and learn to hear and get in the Spirit, there are hidden treasures and mysteries waiting for me and you. It goes beyond tradition. See, it goes beyond this book. Because this is a place of relationship and fellowship in the Spirit of God, where His character begins to take over your character. Where the Word of God that says He was in Christ is a new creation. Where that new creation of Christ, man, I feel the anointing even right now, let me tell you something. Where you and I can go into a place, Jesus said, I am the door. In other words, He opened up a whole arena, a whole realm for me and you that awaits us if you're willing to go into these places. Something we have to continuously do is deny ourselves. You know, the Word says that of all the things that Jesus did, it couldn't be written in enough books. He'd wallpaper the whole world. He couldn't contain it all. And there are things that God is wanting to bring revelation to me and you in the Spirit, where His character becomes one, where you don't ask, you know. You know when to wait. You know when to go. You know. You know. Because see, in Him, in this arena, you are able to go omnipresent. And that's a representation of past, present, and future. In other words, you're able to tie things in. They come one and become like such a revelation to you that it's no longer you. It's no longer you. This is where the place Paul wanted to get, where he said, I want to be at the place where it's no longer I that live, but you that live. And there is a place in the arena in the Spirit God is awaiting for me and you to go to. Everybody with me? And He just gave us the formula. He said, receive my words. And I pray tonight that there be an impartation of God's word that will not just be His word, but it will be His voice and His presence and His character be imparted in you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. That the character of Christ will be overtaking your old character. See, you were born with a character. You were born with a personality. You are a specific person. In you, God's character wants to be unionized with your character. But it's no longer your character, but He's expressing His character through your character. Does that make sense to anybody? Good. Tell me about it later. Hallelujah. He says, and treasure my commands within you, so that you incline your ear to wisdom. Wisdom is a place where fellowship with the Spirit of wisdom, whom God is, the wisdom of God became natural, became tangible, so you and I can touch Jesus with the wisdom of God. Amen? So that this wisdom inclined in us, wisdom tells us what to do. Listen, He says, and apply your heart to understanding. Yes, if you cry out for discernment. You see, now discernment is a fruit of wisdom. Discernment is the fruit of wisdom. Because without wisdom, you can't discern. and lift your voice for understanding. If you seek her as silver and search for her as hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord or the reverence of God. You will understand the presence of God Almighty. You will understand the anointing. You will understand His Word. You will understand not just things that are written, but things that are true. Not things that are just told to you, but things that are true. There's an arena that God is going to bring us where it's no longer you that live, but He does. Where His character is overtaking your character. Where your thoughts are now the thoughts of Christ. Where you're able to wait. Where you're able to see. You're able to go. Oh, hallelujah. Verse 6, for the Lord gives wisdom, from His mouth come knowledge and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. Ooh. He is a shield to those who walk uprightly. He preserves the way of His saints. Are you His saints? Amen. Then you will understand righteousness and justice, equity, and every good path. Wisdom says what to do. The fruit of wisdom is discernment. Wisdom is an area where you and I have such fellowship that we are always constantly reverencing His presence. See, if I was to walk with you, or you were to walk with somebody, you would acknowledge their presence, wouldn't you? Amen? All of a sudden, you'd separate, and you don't acknowledge that presence. But there's a place where you will acknowledge the presence of the Lord in your everyday life. And as you acknowledge His presence, His presence will manifest. His presence will rest upon you. But you must first acknowledge His presence. You must discern. You must understand as His character begins to form in you, you do not want to quench the Spirit. You don't want to do anything to offend that presence because you always want that presence on you. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. Go to Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 5. And please read it with me. Is everybody there? Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And what? In all of your ways acknowledge Him and He will direct your path. There's a place in the presence of the Spirit where there's constant acknowledgement that you know that every step you take is directed by Him. In fact, you won't take a step unless you know it's directed by Him. Because you don't want to walk out of that presence either. And verse 7, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and what? Oh, hallelujah. In other words, acknowledge the presence of God. Acknowledge Him. Acknowledge Him. Reverence Him. When you do, you'll begin to depart from evil. Only until then can you depart from evil, when you first can acknowledge and reverence the Lord. Or you will say things you shouldn't. You will do things you shouldn't. You will quench the Spirit. You will walk out of His presence. You will offend Him until you can actually acknowledge the reverence and fear of the Lord, which is a representation of His constant presence. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be what? Health to your flesh. Praise God. And strength to your bones. So let me share something with you. It says, fear the Lord and depart from evil. Depart from evil says, don't go there. It says, don't go there. There are places where you and I are not to go to. We have a teaching called Boundaries of Worldliness. But I want to share a couple other things tonight, and I want to share tonight about don't go there. There are places where you and I have no right to go because it will cause you to walk out of the presence of God. Does everybody understand? It will cause you to reject the fear of the Lord and accept the fear of bondage. Don't go there. Does everybody understand that? Depart from evil means don't go there. Hello? You know, there's an old saying that says that people have said it takes more of a man to walk away from a fight than to get in it. See, what the devil wants to do is always cause you to get into a fight with him. If you get in the boxing ring with him, you will lose every time. Does everybody understand that? You'll lose. The only time that you go in that ring is when the Lord goes with you. He doesn't send you alone. And let me tell you something, 99.5% of the time, God is telling you, don't go in the ring. He's telling you, don't go there. Don't go there. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. Go to Psalm 34. Psalm 34. Yes. Psalm 34 and verse 8. Oh, something's going to happen tonight. The devil's going to get exposed again. Would you read starting at verse 8? Is everybody there? Whoa. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in Him. Oh, fear the Lord, you His saints. There is no want to those who want. Oh, man, if you reverence Him, let me share with you. I don't know if I can express this in the common words, but there's a place where there's such reverence that His character has overtaken you. And there is no want because every need is met. And you know that every need will be met. So you don't want. The only desire you have is His presence. There is no fear, only His presence. There is pure love that radiates and penetrates through your heart with such trust that the only thing that matters is His presence. And you don't want to. You know how when somebody, when the first time you pick up a baby, you know? I mean, it's like this little flesh creature. This little baby, so innocent, such smooth skin. I mean, you know, they're goo-goo and gaga and whatever. And man, they need you so badly, and you're so sensitive to them. And you don't want to do anything. I remember the first time when, let's see, it's been a long time since my other daughter, who's 33, so I'm going to go back to a Lissy that's been 4 years. And I remember when they first put Lissy in my arms, and I was like, whoa, I don't want to hurt her. I mean, what? And then, you know, then the father nature just took over and said, give me the bottle, praise God. No, it's for the baby, not me. And but you wanted to be so delicate. You wanted to not, you know, you just wanted to please that child. You didn't want to offend that child. You just wanted to make that child happy. No matter what, that's what God wants us to do in His presence. Treat His presence like it's everything. It's all that matters is His presence. That's it. See, you're going to have His presence forever, but you can have it right now. That's all you got to do is follow His formula. Amen? Fear the Lord and depart from evil. In other words, don't go there. When the devil tries to suck you in the ring, don't go there. Okay, let's go a little further. In verse 5, let's read it again. Oh, fear the Lord, you His saints. There is no want to those who fear Him. The young lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. Seeking the Lord just doesn't mean, oh, I'm going to praise and worship all day. Oh, I'm going to fight to seek Him. Sometimes seeking the Lord is just acknowledging Him. Fear and reverence to God is seeking the Lord. Now, the Bible says, seek ye the kingdom of God, and all things will be added unto you. So as you go to the Lord directs you where to go in the body of Christ to get direction. Does everybody understand it? When you need something, you go to seek the kingdom of God. You go to the Lord, and then He brings something to you through the body of Christ. He's always blessing through His body, isn't He? Amen? So when there's food needed, when things are needed, you seek the Lord and all things will be added onto you because you're going getting things from the kingdom of God. That's His storehouses. Every congregation, every fellowship has some kind of storehouse. God has planted a storehouse in every place, whether it can be food, clothes, or finances, or counsel, whatever. That's a part of His storehouse. Does everybody understand that? So as you seek the kingdom of God, all things will be added on to you. Hallelujah. Now, verse 11. Come, you children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Why is He expressing the fear of the Lord? Because once you grasp the understanding and the reverence and fear to God, you will depart from evil. In other words, you won't go there. Who is a man who desires life and loves many days that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil. Now He's giving you a little counsel, correction, and direction. Keep your tongue from what? Evil. Well, that means depart from evil. Everybody got it? Depart from evil. By what? By what you say. And your lips from speaking deceit. Depart from evil. Depart from evil and what? Do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are open to their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who what? Do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry out and the Lord hears and delivers them out of what? All their troubles. All their troubles. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart and such as have a contrite spirit. Read 19 with me. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Oh, if we could just get that. Oh, if we could just get that. We wouldn't try to fix everything. You know, every time you try to fix everything, you try to fix things yourself without seeking the Lord first, without getting direction on what to do, you reject him. You reject him. And when you reject him, you open yourself up to another spirit. Oh, they're all around waiting to come in. They're knocking at our door. Amen? This is where people lose the reverence of God or the fear of the Lord because they can't depart from evil. The Bible tells us you and I are to hate evil. We are to hate it. It's the only thing he says to hate. Hate evil. Hate evil. Hate speaking evil. Hate thinking evil. Hate being around evil. Hate evil in people. Hate evil. Hate it. When you begin to hate it, hate drugs. It's evil. Look what it does, everybody. Hate pornography. Hate lying. Hate it. Hate prostitution. Hate the wickedness of evil. Hate ungodly counsel. It's evil. Hate the ways of the world. Hate it. And hate your old life. Hate it. Everybody understand it? That's called departing from evil. Oh, hallelujah. Go to Ephesians 6. Everyone say, don't go there.
Don't go there.
Go to Ephesians 6, though. Glory to God. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might, not your own. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil or the trickery of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Stand and withstand the cunningness and craftiness of the devil. What he wants to do is draw you off course, suck you in the boxing ring, only with him. But we must come to a place where we say, don't go there. See, what the devil wants to do is draw you out of your protection. When you start moving in the flesh and you start fixing things yourself and start trying to, you just walked out of the presence of God, and the devil sees this neon light that comes on with bullseye and saying, here I am. See, the Lord's going, go back there. Go back there. Go back there. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Praise God. Is everybody all right? Oh, praise God. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And verse 3. We've heard this many times before. Let's get it in. Read it with me. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. So who wants to bring in the flesh? Amen. The powers of darkness, don't they? For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. Strongholds are lies. They are memory lies. They are a lie that's been imparted in your thoughts. And behind every lie is bondage. And behind every bondage is fear. Everybody got it? Behind every bondage is fear. Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of the truth of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ and being ready to punish all of these lies when your obedience is fulfilled. Oh, hallelujah. A stronghold in the mind. Like I said, behind every stronghold is a lie. Behind every lie is fear. And behind every fear is an idol. Because what you're doing is you're replacing something with God's provision or promises. you're accepting something else and it becomes an idol to you. People think that an idol is something that you just worship. It's something you believe. Does everybody understand that? So if you believe the report of the devil compared to the report of the Lord, you just grabbed onto an idol and you've built yourself a stronghold that's been imparted in you, and the devil will have access to you in that area until that place is, it can't be removed. It must be replaced. It can't be removed. It must be replaced. It must be replaced with the truth. Does everybody understand it? Because once something is engraved, it can't be erased. Does everybody understand that? Things of your life are not erased, are they? But they're replaced with light so that those dark areas and those lies in your life no longer have dominion over you because the light has taken dominion over them. Does everybody understand that? So a stronghold is actually a memory lie. It's a lie that's imparted in your mind, in your thoughts. It's also known as a corruptible seed. Even something that you've accepted as truth, but it's not truth, it's a lie. It becomes a stronghold to you. Behind that stronghold is a lie. Behind that lie is fear, and behind that fear is an idol. Because you've accepted something else besides the truth. Does everybody understand that? Praise God. Oh, hallelujah. Go to Matthew chapter 4. Glory! Matthew chapter 4. Praise God. Praise be to God. You know, in certain areas of your life where you compromise, because there's a stronghold there. Why? Because there's a lie there, isn't there? And there's fear of giving up something, or fear. And behind that fear, there's an idol because you're not accepting the full provisions and the promises of God. You're accepting something else. You're accepting the lie. In verse 1, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. See, he went there so you didn't have to. Everybody got it?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So when the devil starts hitting you, just say, don't go there, because he went there. Listen, and when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterward, he was hungry. When the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. So we know he was tempting him, wasn't he? Well, Jesus didn't say, well, you know, he didn't have communication with the devil. I mean, he didn't say, you know, I would really like to make this bread because I'm very hungry. You know what? Jesus didn't go there. He took out the sword of the Spirit and severed what the devil was saying, cut it from him. And he said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. See, he was actually shooting the devil. He was trying to tell the devil, I am God. That's why the Bible says that God can't be tempted. Does everybody understand that?
Hallelujah.
Amen. Then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, he was always tempting him. Well, he's trying to bring him to a place where he's trying to plant a corruptible seed to wonder if he was the Son of God. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it's written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Now the devil loves to use the word of God against you too. And Jesus said to him, I'm not going there. It is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Again, he confessed himself as God to the devil, didn't he? Again, the devil took him up in an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdom of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all of these are for you. So he tempted him all of these areas. He tempted by lust of the flesh. He's tempting him by lust of the eye and pride of life. And Jesus said, I am not going there. Don't go there. And he stayed his ground. He stood and he withstood. And Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. And he was confessing himself as God again, wasn't he? Amen? Now, you and I are the sons of God, and daughters of God. No, listen. The Lord went there so you and I don't have to. We're to be the exact same example. We have the exact same power and anointing that he left it for me and you so that you and I don't go there. See, the devil tried to tempt him and bring him on his side, bring him into the ring, because he knew if he could get him in the ring, he could disarm him. He could disqualify him. If he could put any reasoning in him, which is the guillotine of faith, he could disqualify him and disarm him. Then he would try to look at his own strength instead of relying on the strength of the presence of God. Does everybody understand that? The devil always wants to bring you to you. Always. If he can bring you to you, you just disarmed yourself from the presence of God. You just disqualified yourself. Because now your eyes are not on what the Lord has done or what he can do. Your eyes are on what you can do or what has happened with you. Woe is me again. Amen? Is everybody all right? Oh, hallelujah. Matthew 6. Simple teaching tonight. Quick impartation. Glory to God. All the glory. Matthew chapter 6. Verse 24. Please go there. Would you read it with me? No one can serve two masters. Oh, there it is. Nobody can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore I say to you, do not what? Do not worry. Didn't he? Hey, listen, look at the connection between money and worry. Do not worry about your life and what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? In other words, don't go there. Don't go there. Amen? Don't go there. Go to 3 John. You know, I've told this story before, and my wife used to get up very early in the morning as a surgical nurse, and so I used to go to bed a little bit later than her. And one night she went to bed, and she got up before I went to bed, and she said she had a dream about these little foxes that were beautiful. And she said they went right underneath the bedroom door, flattened out and went right up the door and crawled up her leg and started biting her, and she realized that these foxes were vicious, but they looked so beautiful at first. And she woke up and she told me about this. And then I went to bed that night, and I had a dream. And I had a dream that the Lord was, there was this boxing ring, and there was all these people around and cheering, and the Lord was putting like a robe on me, you know, like what they wear before they go out and box, and he had this robe on me, and he's putting gloves on me, and he's tightening them up, and I'm going, Lord, I'm not in shape for this, you know, I haven't boxed, and then I'd say, well, but for you, I'll do it, and we'd go about 5 or 6 steps, and I would stop and go, wait a minute, wait a minute. Lord, I haven't boxed in years. I don't know what, you know. And then, all right, but for you, I'll do it. And then he put the other glove on, and he starts tightening it up. And I get right to the ring, and I stop, and I said, Lord, I'm not it. And I said, okay, for you, I'll do it. And he tied it up, and I got in the ring, and I woke up. Well, the next day, I had a business meeting, and we were manufacturing a product. It was the Vine of Life juice with scriptures on it. And there was a location that we were putting it in. There was a Christian place, a Christian facility, a Christian store and everything. And people were calling and loving the stuff. And so I was going back there to replenish it. And the guy called me up and he said, you know, I remember that day you told me about your testimony. And would you come on in before you put any more of your juice in here? He said, would you come on in and tell me about this testimony, about your encounter with the Lord? So I went over there and I walked in there and I walked in this back room and he shut the door and him and I were just sitting there talking and he said, so tell me about this encounter. And I shared with him about my encounter with the Lord and shared with him I was a drug addict for many years and so forth, this, that, whenever. And all of a sudden the guy just, I mean, his whole countenance just changed. And he just said, you know, what happened to you was an illusion. And of course I stopped for a moment and then he said to me, you know, it's just a reaction from the drugs. I said, man, this happened 2 months after I had been clean, 2 months already. And then I had this encounter with the Lord. I said, man, I am totally changed. And he tried to bring me scripturally, and I shared with him what happened to Saul, happened to me, this, that, whatever. And then two other guys came in the door and stood there and covered the door. Now these guys started, like, verbally saying, man, this, and that, and, you know, where you're going to church, this and that, and what you believe in isn't correct, this and that. And I was getting, like, bombarded by these demonic forces. And when I looked at this one guy, I saw this huge shadow. And I said, Lord, I'm just going to fall on my knees and pray. And the Holy Ghost, he said, don't, they'll kill you. I'm like, whoa, it's okay. And I'm thinking, whoa. And so I started binding the powers of darkness. And the Lord said, don't worry. He says, I'm going to make a way of escape for you. I said, all right. And then they were telling me, you know, with your long hair, we're going to teach you how to be a man and this and that. And I'm like, oh. I'm thinking, oh, man, Lord, is this that ring you were telling me about and the three foxes? And I'm thinking this. I'm going, whoa. I mean, my wife had this dream and I had this dream. And I'm thinking about things I need to go to. And it kept coming to me like, don't go there. Don't go there. Don't go there. Just don't go in your own strength. Don't lean on your own understanding. I'm using you to implant something there. And so forth, and I'm showing you. And I saw, then all of a sudden I had a vision of this guy with a sawed-off shotgun, double barrel, shooting and killing people that were moving in the gifts and the spirit. And the Lord shared with me, this is religion. And I'm thinking, wow, Lord. And then he revealed to me on how they treated their own children and how they beat them with the word and all kinds of other stuff. And I thought, Lord, and how their wives are fearful of them. And I mean, these things were all just imparted in me at one time. And then he started giving me some other things that he said to me, don't go there, you know, because I wanted to get out of there. And the Lord made way, and one of these guys, and then the Holy Spirit revealed something to me about one person, and because they were trying to make themselves so holy, and I showed it to this one guy, you smoke, don't you? And so forth. And he says, yes, well, I'm trying to quit. And I said, well, you call that holy? And so anyways, then it really just kind of shrugged him off and shook them off a little bit, where the guy moved away from the door, and I just calmly went to the door and opened it. And when I opened the door, I made sure my foot was in there so they couldn't shut it. And they were kind of like all standing still, and they couldn't like budge. And I know my dad was holding them back. And I said to them, you may not understand this, but you have just blasphemed the Holy Spirit. And you have offended the Lord. And you need to seek God the Father and find out the truth, because you're leading people astray. And I walked out of the room. I was so drained. I could barely drive home. My head was like nodding off of the steering. I was so drained. I got home. I walked to the front door, and I fell right in the living room. And Mom and my wife were there. And they came over and laid hands on me and prayed in the Holy Ghost, and I got refreshed and got up. And it was an experience. And the Lord revealed to me about this religious garbage. That's why I hate religion, because I see how it does to people. Spiritually, it kills them. It kills them. But I couldn't hate the individuals. I could only hate what the powers of darkness were doing. Because, see, I couldn't go there. You understand that? We can't go there. You and I must be in a place where we want nothing more than the presence of God. And no matter what people are saying, you know, one of the number one things that people offend when they get offended, oh, man, it's the simplest thing to move someone off track. Because that's how, and, you know, offense is a representation of protecting yourself. Offense is a fruit of pride. It doesn't mean that you're going to get offended. But when you take it as an offense, and you take it further than you should, it becomes prideful. It's a fruit of pride. Because you know what? You can't offend someone dead. You try to scream to somebody dead, ain't nothing going to happen. That's where you and I are dead in the flesh and alive in the spirit. This is where it's no longer you that live, but Christ that lives. This is where you're coming to an arena and an area where the character of Christ is manifesting through you. He didn't say anything when he was persecuted. He didn't say nothing when they spit at him, and did all kinds of other things. He didn't try to defend himself. He didn't try to prove himself, because he already was. And so are you. See, he already went there for you, so you don't have to go there. Everybody got it?
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. Let's go a little further. Did we go there yet? Third John. Is everybody okay?
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Another level. New devil. Praise God. More exercise. Third John. And verses 1 through 8, I think. 2 through 8. Would you read it with me? Beloved, I pray that you may what? Prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. Now, what is your soul? Your mind, your will, and your emotions. So they must prosper. In other words, you've got to come to an arena where you can't allow your mind, your feelings, and your choices to go into places where they have no right to go. God has set boundaries for each and every one of his children. There is a place where you cannot go. And he may allow someone else to go there because he knows it won't cause offense. Jesus went into the wilderness because he could go there. Does everybody understand that? He went there so you and I didn't have to. But it doesn't mean that you won't be tempted, does it? It doesn't mean that you won't be challenged, does it? But when you're tempted and you're challenged, you must go to a place where you are not caught in and sucked in to the arena of the devil's domain, because you'll lose the fight. He'll plant that corruptible seed in you, and you'll have a hard time, because that's what he wants to do, is plant corruptible seeds. Let's go a little further. For I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Beloved, you do faithfully whatever you do for the brethren and for strangers, and who have borne witness of your love before the church, if you send them forward on their journey in a manner worthy of God, you do well. Because they went forth for his name's sake, taking nothing from the Gentiles. We therefore ought to receive such, that we may become fellow workers of the truth. The truth is what sets you free. Amen? The truth is going to say, don't go there. See, because if you really know the truth, you don't need to go there, do you? If you're fellowshipping with the truth, and the truth is in you and manifesting in you, you don't need to go there. Because the presence of God is a manifestation of his truth. And this is where reverence and fear and truth are associated with each other. Oh, hallelujah. Go to 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. Glory. Glory. Verse 7. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 7. 7 through 9. Why don't you read it with me? Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God, it was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. Now listen, it says, whoever has been born of God does not sin. Sin is a representation of the presence of evil. Sin is the representation of the presence of evil. In other words, you're not associating with the presence of evil. You're associating with the presence of God. And his seed remains in you. In other words, that is the righteous seed that is remaining in you. And he cannot sin because he is born of God. In other words, in this arena where the righteous seed is being watered, where it's growing and bearing fruit, where the corruptible seed that's been imparted has been destroyed. See, the devil is always, every time you associate with sin or the presence of evil, the devil has an access to you to plant a corruptible seed. So remember that every time you associate with the presence of evil, which is representation of sin, the devil has a legal right to plant a corruptible seed in you. Everybody got it? He's got a legal right to plant a corruptible seed in you. Okay. What did I say to go 1 John? Oh, we were there. Okay. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Holy Ghost knew. Praise be to God. Holy Ghost knows. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 6. Glory to God. Would you read it with me? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his reward according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field, you are God's building. Let me share something with you, that a corruptible seed will contaminate your soil. Corruptible seed will contaminate your soil because you are known as good ground. You are supposed to be known as the field. Amen? So what happens is when you do not depart from evil and you associate with evil, you're either getting a corruptible seed imparted in you or the corruptible seed is being watered. Has everybody got it? Either the corruptible seed is being imparted or a corruptible seed is being watered. Every time you go there, one of these things will happen. Either be imparted, a corruptible seed, or it'll be watered. Go to Romans 8. Hallelujah. You know, the Word tells us that there's going to be much deception. So, and there's much demonic activity. There is a tremendous amount of demonic activity. Tremendous amount. All over. It's getting worse. It's not getting better. It's getting worse. People are just blatantly coming out and expressing themselves as Satan worshipers. And they're finding dead animals in homes and things to that degree. They don't care. I mean, you know, years and years ago, they wouldn't have been brought right out. In fact, some people, they would have, I mean, some of the organizations that are manifesting today, they would have shut them down and thrown them out of the country saying they were communists. But it's not happening now because it's been infiltrated, even in the judges, the Supreme Court judges, and so forth. It's all a plan of God also. He's allowing certain things to happen. Because things must reach their climax. Evil must reach its climax so that righteousness reaches its climax. But there is a war in the heavenlies that is tremendous, and it's increasing more and more. And you can either assist in this war and assist the powers of Christ or assist the powers of darkness on what you do. Amen? In Romans chapter 8 and verse 12. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will what? You die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will what? For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the what? These are the sons of... Listen, if you're led by the Spirit of God, you reject the corruptible seed. Does everybody understand it? As you're led by the Spirit of God, you will reject the corruptible seed. As you are led by the voice of the stranger, or by the flesh, or by your desires and so forth, you accept the corruptible seed. For you did not receive the spirit of what? Bondage again to what? Fear. Now wait a minute. This is what we were talking about before, weren't we? The spirit of bondage. Isn't a stronghold bondage? Isn't that a corruptible seed? It's a memory lie. It's a corruptible seed, isn't it? And what's behind every lie? Fear. What's behind every fear? An idol. Everybody got it? So he says, and that's all associated with bondage, isn't it? Yeah. So what's happened is an individual has accepted this lie as a truth and has replaced the provisions of God and the promises of God with this lie. So that became an idol. Fear is Satan's power. Fear. You did not receive the spirit of bondage again through fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out what? Abba, Father. That's relationship. That's God's presence. That's fellowship. Everybody got it? Oh, hallelujah. For the Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with Him, that we may also be glorified together. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which will be revealed in us. In other words, Paul said, man, just put up with it. In other words, don't go there. Don't go there. For their earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. Man, they're waiting for me and you. Hallelujah. Okay. Turn to Genesis 3. Genesis chapter 3. Praise be to God. Genesis chapter 3, starting at verse 1. This is where Sister Eve got in the ring and got KO'd in the first round. Everybody got it? Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, as God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said to the serpent, that was her first mistake, we may not eat the fruit of the trees of the garden. What is she trying to do? Prove herself, what she knew. But the fruit of the tree of... which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you what? Touch it, lest you what? Die. So she knew what the truth was, but the first thing she should have obeyed was, don't go near that tree. She went there, didn't she? Don't go there. So no, listen, she went there and got a 1-2-3 punch and got KO'd Hello, knocked out in the first round, and that corruptible seed was imparted in her, and contamination went not only through the whole soil of mankind, but through the whole soil of the earth. And everything was contaminated. Does everybody understand that? Just because she went there. Oh, hallelujah. You know, one of the things that was very profound is she said, don't even touch. How many things do we touch in the spirit? How many things do we compromise and pet in the spirit? Those are corruptible seeds. You touch them. See, people keep looking at tangible touch. No, everything that manifests in the natural realm has been first touched in the spirit realm. There's nothing that has manifested in the natural realm that's not been associated with the spirit realm first. Everybody got it? Don't go there. Proverbs 18. You need to get this imparted in you so that you can always say, when you're being tempted and so forth, don't go there. Don't go there. Man, it's happened. You know, it's been going on with me all day long. All day long I've had to go, don't go there. Don't go there. And just depart from evil. Don't go there. Don't go there. The battle belongs to the Lord. Don't go there. Your obedience is what moves the hand of God. Your disobedience is what moves the hand of the devil. Proverbs 18. Oh, hallelujah. Is everybody there? In verse 21, read it, please. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. Ooh, death and life. In other words, what you speak is going to either bring death or life. You're either going to water the corruptible seed or the righteous seed. One is going to bear fruit and bring glory to the Lord. The other one's going to bear fruit and bring death. Everybody got it? In other words, don't go there. Don't get sucked in that ring. You'll lose every time. Life and death and the power of the tongue. 1 Peter chapter 1. Don't water that seed. 1 Peter chapter 1. Hallelujah. You know, some people have a hard time with unforgiveness or forgiveness. Sometimes they can't forgive because they've been wounded. But they deserve what they get. Well, there's a corruptible seed there big time. And the Lord is saying, don't go there, kill it, you know. And sometimes people have a hard time forgiving themselves. That's another corruptible seed. It's no difference. If you can't forgive someone else, or if you can forgive someone else but you can't forgive yourself, that's a corruptible seed. And the Lord is saying, don't go there, isn't he? 1 Peter chapter 1, in verse 13, please. What does it say? Read it with me. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be what? Sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all of your conduct, because it is written, be holy for what? I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in what? Fear or reverence, knowing that you are not redeemed with what? Corruptible things or corruptible seeds, like silver or gold, from your aimless conduct received by traditions from your father, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead, and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God and not you. Your faith and hope cannot be in your pastor, cannot be in your relatives, cannot be in nobody. Your faith and your hope must be in the Lord. It's in the Lord. Your spouses can't rescue you. Your children can't rescue you. Your ex-girlfriends that you broke all those soul ties off with now can't rescue you. Nobody can rescue you. Only Jesus. That's it. Only the Lord. Amen?
Yeah.
Oh, hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. He is your deliverer. Just don't go there. You don't have to worry about deliverance. That's a part of maintaining your deliverance, is don't go there. The Bible tells us it's an abomination to God to build on things that he's delivered you from. In verse 17, therefore means if you come out from among them, Is everybody with me? Therefore, come out from among them and be what? Separate, says the Lord, and do not what? Oh, hallelujah. Don't go there. Do not touch what is what? Unclean. And I will what? Receive you. And I'll be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Therefore, having these what? Promises. Beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, and perfecting holiness in the what? Fear of God, reverence to God, your desires to have the presence of God in your life. Everybody got it? Like I said, the number one thing that causes this open door, causes you to go there, is offense. It's the number one thing. Go there to prove self. Or actually, in some areas, we think we're better with pride. Amen? Causes you to go there. Offense. Well, I didn't like that, what was preached last night. I'm not going to that church anymore. Well, I didn't like how the pastor talked to me, or I didn't like how this person or that person, or listen, it depends what you do with it. God is not saying that you won't be offended, but don't allow it to become such an offense that it allows a corruptible seed in there. That's where the word says, depart from evil. Depart from it. Amen? Forgive. Depart from it. It says, forgive those and bless those who persecute you, use you, and speak against you. Forgive them. Let it go. If you hold on, that corruptible seed is going to get watered. It could be the most tormenting thing in your life. Offense. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. I'm going to give you, about 8 things. Ephesians chapter 4. The number one is what? Offense. Offense. What about when you get shorted money in your check that week? Oh man, people get really offended. Ooh-wee, because that idol is big time there. Remember, it said you can't serve two masters. It's talking about the money, the God of the world, money and stuff like that, right? That's why the Lord says give first fruits. Amen. Hallelujah. You kidding me? I worked hard for that first check. Praise God. Die. Not yours anyways. But if you get in His presence and you die a little bit, the Bible says, fear the Lord and you won't lack anything.
Amen.
Yeah, but, oh, you're going to have butt ministry. We're the head, not the tail, right? Praise God. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25. Therefore what? Put them out. Read with me, please. Therefore putting away lying. That's known as exaggeration, manipulation. Lying. Trying to waver someone to get something your way. That's called lying. Let each one of you speak what? Truth. With his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. In other words, be angry. Okay, you got offended, but don't associate with the presence of evil. Let it go. Forgive. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Hello, he wants to either impart that corruptible seed or water the one that's in there. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, like gossip, coarse jesting. But what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearer? You know what? The devil loved to use you to impart a corruptible seed in someone. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all what? Bitterness. Here's more of them. Wrath. Anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. In other words, don't go there. These are areas that we are not to go to. Does everybody understand it? Be careful of what you speak. It says, don't give place to the devil. Don't give place to him. The way you don't give place to him is by not going there. Amen. That's why it's so important to fellowship. Because there's things that, let me tell you, the devil is sly. You don't know it's happening until it happened. Well, not me. Well, then it's already happened to you. Mr. Pride. Has everybody got it? It's that simple. He is so sly. Never think that you can do it yourself and outwit the devil. You can't. You do not have the knowledge or the understanding to. But you have the mind of Christ, where you can stay one step ahead of him and not go where you have no right to go. Just like Sister Eve, like I said, she got in a ring and was knocked right out, man. Three punches, lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and pride of life. It was over with. First round. Corruptible seed, bam, contaminated the whole good ground, soil, and the earth. Oh, hallelujah. Okay, Matthew 11. Are you getting this? Are you going to say don't go there?
Yeah.
Today was definitely a day of don't go there. Depart from evil. Verse 28 and 29 and 30. Jesus said, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Where are you learning from? Well, when he was tempted, he didn't go there, did he? He went there for me and you, so we didn't have to go there. He said, learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Resting for your souls is a representation of renewing, okay, which you will prosper healthily, health-wise, wisdom, knowledge, understanding. Verse 30, for my yoke is easy and my burden is what? Oh, praise God. You know, one of the things that really cause people problems is being a busybody. They pick up burdens they have no right to. They just choose to pick up a burden. Somebody's got a burden, they decide to go along with them. Oh, what a burden. And because they picked up this burden, they think it's the will of God when it's not. Jesus just said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Any burden that's heavy is not God. Hello? Don't be a busybody and pick up people's burdens. Amen. That's the third thing. Go to Philippians 4. Oh, hallelujah. Philippians 4. Oh, praise you, Lord. Verse 6, what does it say? Be what? Anxious for nothing. Oh, praise God. Would everybody underline the word nothing? You know what nothing means? Nothing. It means like zip, zero, capital zero. Be anxious for what?
Nothing.
The only reason why you become anxious is because a corruptible seed has been imparted. Hello? And what happens is you're afraid that you're going to lose something. And behind every lie, because you've accepted the lie that you're going to lose something, there's fear there. And then what happens is there's what? An idol, because you're saying that God cannot provide what he's supposed to. And it becomes a stronghold. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. So the fourth thing is what? Be anxious for nothing. Go to James chapter 1. Don't go there. James chapter 1. Hallelujah. In verse 2. My brethren, count it all miserable. Count it all what?
Joy.
Praise God. That's the fifth thing you got to do. Is count it all joy. When you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking what? And it says, listen, if you lack, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. So we see here that the reason why individuals are miserable, because that lie, the corruptible seed, has been imparted. They've gone to an area which has allowed the devil to impart. They made place, and it's being watered. In other words, you misunderstood something. And the devil is just building this picture bigger, bigger, and bigger. Somebody said something about something, and man, the devil just keeps expanding it like a balloon blowing up. It's all a bunch of hot air. Amen? And the truth comes and pops it. And you realize, whoa, that's not the truth at all. But the devil drew this picture of this individual or individuals or a ministry. There's many people that the devil has said all kinds of stuff just because we live in a cul-de-sac. They thought it was a cul-de-sac. And people go, man, that place is a cult. Then they come here and get delivered and healed and filled with the Holy Ghost. Then they realize that what they were told was a lie. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. So we need to remove these lies. Amen. We need to stay in the joy of the Lord. Number five, stay with joy. Let me tell you what, always keep joy. Being grateful. Being grateful. You know, don't look at the past. Be grateful. Just be grateful. Don't let the devil bring condemnation and guilt of what you should have done and how you should have done it. Just do it. Be grateful. Amen? Go to James 4 while we're here. In verse 7 and 8, it says, therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. In other words, submit to the ways of God. Be obedient. Submit to the offices and the authorities that God has given over you. Submit to his word. And repent. Look at it, says, draw near to God, and he'll draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. In other words, repent. You know those corruptible seeds. You know the, you know when there's irritation. You know every day you wake up, there's that same old thing over and over and over. That is a corruptible seed. There's been a door that's been opened from the devil. You've allowed something in, and you need to kill it. Somewhere where you've gone, it's allowed it to happen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Would you go back to James 1 again? While we're in James. Hallelujah. James chapter 1. In verse 12 and 14. 12 through 14. It says, James chapter 1, 12 through 14. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his what? Own desires and enticed. So these ungodly desires must be removed. You must acknowledge these ungodly desires. And praise be to God. Go to Psalm 127. Here's the last one. This will be number 8. Psalm 127. So you're supposed to count it all joy, not get into woe is me syndrome, right? And self-martyrism. Don't go there. Psalm 127. Glory to God, I believe. Is everybody there? Would you read it with me, the first two verses? Unless the Lord builds a house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards a city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early and to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows. Hello. For so he gives his beloved sleep. And the eighth one, which is a representation of new beginning, says, let the Lord build your house and don't go there. Amen? Father, we thank you for your word tonight. And Lord, in anywhere that we have gone where we shouldn't have gone and a corruptible seed has been imparted or one has been watered, we curse that corruptible seed and associated spirits as we repent for having the associating with the presence of evil. And we ask for your blessing as we sever and command these spirits to loose us, and that you would continue to fill us with the Holy Spirit, that your righteous seed will grow and bear fruit for your glory, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.